Today it's going to be lecture 9 of our discourse on comparative public administration. And today we are going to talk about the heart and soul of the discipline, the bureaucracy itself. Let me go over what we discussed last time. In lecture 8, we talked about the new public administration and the paradigm shift by the new public management in 1988, which had a lot of impact on the discipline and profession of public administration. As we saw, the First Minnowbrook Conference held in US in 1968 highlighted the equity, ethics, and human relation aspects of public administration. It also talked a lot about accountability, how to make the bureaucrats, the public administrators, more accountable. And of course, that was in the background of what was happening to public sector organizations, what was missing. And the second Minnowbrook Conference took up the concepts of leadership, what kind of leader is required for the new public management setup. It emphasized the legal perspective a lot, aur usme information technology ke bare mein bhi, kafi baat ki gayi ki usko kaise integrate karna hai public administration ko behtar banane ke liye. Aur new public management ka phir jab concept evolve hua 1990s mein, jis duran uski practice ko Thatcherism or Reaganism ka naam bhi diya gaya, kyunki us zamane mein bahut zyada in dono leaders ne privatization ki. To new public management ke mukhtalif aspects, mukhtalif goals, mukhtalif objectives aur uska impact humne study kiya. Basic jo concept tha wo ye tha ki we have to borrow concepts from the private sector and integrate them into the realm of public administration to make it more responsive, to make it more innovative, to make it more market-oriented, to make it more client-focused. Ye sab kuch jo hona tha, uska mainstay, uska basic assumption ye thi ke ab state regulate nahi karegi. It would be the market which would be regulating the economy and the provision of all kinds of services. Aur isi duran economy less wastage, efficiency, more productivity that is, and effectiveness ka concept pesh kiya gaya ki ye jo three E's hain, they should be incorporated in the practice of the profession of public administration, then we can go ahead. Ye sari jo deliberations thi aur jo evolve hua new public management ka concept, iska bepana impact hua practice of the profession पे, यानी गवर्नमेंट्स ने पे इसका बहुत इंपैक्ट हुआ. स्मॉलर गवर्नमेंट्स, रिडक्शन इन गवर्नमेंट की बात होने लगी, जिसको डाउनसाइजिंग भी कहते हैं. उसके अलावा गवर्नमेंट टू बी मार्केट ओरिएंटेड, यानी बिल्कुल प्राइवेट सेक्टर की तरह चलने की बात हुई. बहुत सी कॉरपोरेशन मारज वजूद में आए, क्योंकि मैनेजेरियल ऑटोनॉमी की बात हुई थी. डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन हुई गवर्नमेंट्स की, ताकि ग्रास रूट पे लोगों को रिलीफ मिल सके, ग्रास रूट पे सर्विसेज प्रोवाइड किए जा सके. और रिस्पॉन्सिव गवर्नमेंट का कॉन्सेप्ट आया, एंटरप्रेन्योरल गवर्नमेंट का कॉन्सेप्ट आया. तो ये सारा इम्पैक्ट जो था, ये हमें 1990s में गवर्नमेंट्स की परफॉर्मेंस में नजर आता है. प्राइवेटाइजेशन, कॉन्ट्रैक्टिंग आउट एंड अदर मेनी मेनी मेजर चेंजेस विच टुक प्लेस ड्यूरिंग द 1990s वर ड्यू टू द प्रोपोनेंट ऑफ द न्यू पब्लिक मैनेजमेंट. So what is bureaucracy? We'll look at some definitions. First one, it is a well-defined division of administrative labor among persons and offices. यानी आप persons की भी बात कर रहे हैं और office की बात भी कर रहे हैं. Office goes along with powers. And the person is going to exercise those powers. So administrative labor ya administrative kaam jo hain, unki bahut wazeh taqseem hogi ki kisne kya karna hai aur kis office ka kya kaam hai aur kiske kya powers hai. Ye bilkul clear cut bureaucracy mein hota hai. Another definition, a personnel system with consistent patterns of recruitment and stable linear careers. यानी जिन अफसरान को आप रिक्रूट करेंगे या ब्यूरोक्रेट्स जो बनेंगे मुख्तलिफ डिपार्टमेंट्स में, उनको रिक्रूट करने का एक लेड डाउन तरीका होगा. वो वजह करदा तरीका जो होगा वो चेंज नहीं होगा, उसको हमेशा वैसे ही रहना चाहिए. टू इंश्योर मेरिट, ट्रांसपेरेंसी एंड रेगुलरिटी. और एट द सेम टाइम जो लोग रिक्रूट होंगे उनके कैरियर्स का पैटर्न, कि उन्होंने उनकी प्रमोशन कैसे होनी है, उन्होंने किस पोस्ट पे जाना है, किस तरीके से उनका करियर पाथ डेवलप होना है, ये सब कुछ पहले से तयशुदा होता है. A hierarchy among offices such that the authority and status are differentially distributed among actors. यहां हायरार्की की बात हो रही है, एक नीचे अफसर है, एक ऊपर है, एक उसके ऊपर है, और सबकी अथॉरिटी डिफरेंट है, स्टेटस भी डिफरेंट है, और पावर्स डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड है. So, इस हायरार्की में एक बंदे ने काम करना है, दूसरे ने उसको ओवरसी करना है, तीसरे ने उसके काम को ओवरसी करना है, एंड सो ऑन. एंड ईच पर्सन्स वर्क इज वेल डिफाइंड अकॉर्डिंग टू रूल्स और लॉज. इसकी ओरिजिन क्या है? ये कॉन्सेप्ट जो है ब्यूरोक्रेसी का, इट ओरिजिनेटेड in the 18th century, the term rather, ek desk ya jahan office mein desk pada ho usko bureau kehte the. Phir Sumerian era mein, historically speaking, ek scribe ka concept hua, ek banda jo likh sakta tha aur records rakhta tha badshahon ke liye, isliye wo powerful tha. इसी तरह अगर आप आगे ट्रेस करें हिस्ट्री को तो पर्शियन एम्पायर में बाकायदा सत्रप्स और रॉयल सेक्रेटरीज अपॉइंट होते थे प्रोविंसेस को हेड करने के लिए और रिक्रूटमेंट करने के लिए. और एक बहुत बड़ा कदम ब्यूरोक्रेसी की हिस्ट्री में, एक बहुत बड़ा लैंडमार्क चाइना का है, जहां किन डायनेस्टी के दौरान फादर फिलोसोफर जो चाइनीज का कन्फ्यूशियस, ही सेट अप अ मेरिट बेस्ड सिस्टम ऑफ सिविल सर्वेंट्स कॉल्ड द मैंडरिन्स. और ये बहुत ही ऑर्गेनाइज्ड सिस्टम था, बाकायदा जो मॉडर्न ब्यूरोक्रेसी है उसके तकरीबन सारे कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स इसमें पाए जाते थे. और कहते हैं कि उसकी बहुत कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन है चाइना की उस वक्त की डेवलपमेंट में. और आजकल की जो ब्यूरोक्रेसीज हैं ये इंडस्ट्रियल रेवोल्यूशन के बाद मारज़े वजूद में आई और स्ट्रीमलाइन होती गई और एक खास स्ट्रक्चर इवॉल्व हो गया. अब जरूरत क्यों पड़ती है ब्यूरोक्रेसी की या क्यों पड़ी? सबसे पहले एक फॉर्मल स्टेट एपरेटस बहुत जरूरी होता है हुकूमत के काम चलाने के लिए, स्टेट के काम चलाने के लिए. वो क्यों? स्टेट ने लॉज बनाने और उन्हें इंप्लीमेंट करने, स्टेट ने टैक्सेस भी लगाने हैं, स्टेट ने लॉ एंड ऑर्डर भी प्रोवाइड करना है और कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स को अंडर कंट्रोल रखना है. इट ऑल्सो ऑर्गेनाइजेज योर डिफेंस एंड फॉरेन रिलेशंस एंड इट रेगुलेट्स ट्रेड. ये बेसिक कंपल्शंस जो हैं ये हमेशा से रही हैं जब से नेशन स्टेट का फॉर्मल कॉन्सेप्ट वजूद में आया और नेशन स्टेट्स वजूद में आई, उस वक्त से ये फंक्शंस चल रहे हैं. और इनको परफॉर्म करने के लिए कोई ना कोई फॉर्मल स्ट्रक्चर चाहिए था, उसको ब्यूरोक्रेसी का नाम दे दिया गया. अब कार्ल मार्क्स ने और हेगल ने डायलेक्टिकल मटेरियलिज्म की थ्योरी दी थी जो एक्सप्लॉयटेड और एक्सप्लॉयटर पर मबनी थी, और द पीजेंट्री और वर्किंग क्लास वर एट वन एंड एंड द लैंडलॉर्ड्स एंड द इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट वर एट द अदर. एज अ साइड इशू, कार्ल मार्क्स ऑल्सो स्टडीड द रोल ऑफ ब्यूरोक्रेट्स देन ब्यूरोक्रेट्स. So he found that bureaucracy controls and coordinates the production and distribution of wealth and appropriates part of it. उसने ये देखा कि सिर्फ वो कंट्रोल नहीं कर रहे ये सारी प्रोडक्शन और डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन, बल्कि वो वेल्थ का कुछ पोर्शन अपने लिए रख लेते हैं. उसने कहा bureaucracy is a cost to society, लेकिन उसको टॉलरेट इसलिए करना पड़ता है ताकि सोशल ऑर्डर मेंटेन रहे. और अगर स्टेट ने ही सारे काम करने हैं और वो सारी मींस ऑफ प्रोडक्शन कंट्रोल करेगी तो ये स्टेट का एपरेटस जो है ब्यूरोक्रेसी वो और ज्यादा पावरफुल हो जाएगा और कलेक्टिव इसकी बहुत ज्यादा पावर होगी कलेक्टिवली स्पीकिंग. However, कार्ल मार्क्स का यह ख्याल था कि there is a way out of this if the workers go into the self-management mode, then bureaucracy may become redundant. Bureaucracy की जरूरत नहीं रहेगी अगर worker अपने आप को organize कर ले और self-manage करे अपने काम को. کارل مارکس نے یہ بھی کہا کہ بیوروکریسی جو ہے وہ سوسائٹی اور سٹیٹ کے درمیان خلیج پیدا کرتی ہے جان بوجھ کر, اور اس خلیج سے فائدہ اٹھانے کی کوشش کرتی ہے. اٹ از ایکسپلوئٹیو ان نیچر, یعنی وہ ایکسپلوئٹ کرتی ہے جو بھی مس انڈرسٹینڈنگز کریٹ کراتی ہے بٹوین دا اسٹیٹ اینڈ دا سول سوسائٹی. یعنی اٹ ڈزنٹ پلے اے پازیٹیو رول, اٹ پلیز اے نیگیٹو رول. اٹ آلسو پرزروز دا اسٹیٹس کو, اٹ از ناٹ چینج اورینٹیڈ بٹ اٹ پرزروز دا اسٹیٹس کو. اور ان دا پروسیس اٹ ایکومولیٹس پاور فار اٹس. اور اس پروسیس میں وہ اور پاورفل ہوتی جاتی ہے, اور بیوروکریسی جب بہت زیادہ پاورفل ہو جاتی ہے تو اس کا تعلق میسج سے کم ہو جاتا ہے. اٹ ایلینیٹس اٹ سیلف فرام دا میسج. اینڈ ناؤ وی آر گوئنگ ٹو ٹاک اباؤٹ میکس ویبر اینڈ ہز کانسیپٹ آف بیوروکریسی. میکس ویبر واز اے جرمن سوشیولوجسٹ ہو پروڈیوس لینڈ مارک ورک آن بیوروکریسی اینڈ سوشل آرگنائزیشنز. اکارڈنگ ٹو ہم دا ہسٹوریکل اینڈ ایڈمنسٹریٹو ریزنز فار دا پروسیس آف بیوروکریٹائزیشن ور پریزنٹ, اینڈ آف کورس we have already looked at them, the very existence of the state apparatus and all the functions it had to perform. He reiterated all that. Then the impact of rule of law upon functioning of bureaucratic organizations. He looked how law empowers bureaucratic organizations and how it limits bureaucratic organizations in their exercise of powers. So when we are talking about rule of law, we are talking about equal and uniform treatment of everyone, because rule of law means that all, every citizen is equal before law, and law has to be applied without discrimination of any sort. Then he looked at the typical personal orientation and occupational aspects of bureaucratic officials. He studied the bureaucrat. What kind of a person a typical bureaucrat turns out to be, and what impact occupational forces, occupational compulsions have on his personality. He also analyzed the most important attributes and consequences of bureaucracy. That what are the characteristics of bureaucracy and what impact they have. His theory of bureaucracy or his bureaucratic model is generally called the classic or the ideal model. It is also called the legal rational authority model, because it implies a set of rules and administrative structures which closely control the action of employees of the organization. In return, the bureaucrats share the belief of adhering to the organization's requirements. So it is rational because the structures are laid out, the action of the employees is in keeping with certain rules and regulations, and the bureaucrats or the employees are awarded for their performance. and they are expected to share the objectives of the organization. Max Weber's ko hum bureaucratic theory ka father keh sakte hain. Inki jo theory hai jisko classic ideal bureaucracy ki theory bhi keh sakte hain, legal rational theory bhi keh sakte hain, ek bilkul impersonal aur law abiding bureaucracy ka model inhone pesh kiya. Bureaucracy, uske characteristics, is based upon rules which are accepted by members of the organization. Yani jitne bhi log kaam kar rahe hain us organization mein, wo tamam in rules ko accept karte hain ki humne in rules ke matahat kaam karna hai, meri ye power hai, ye laws hain, aur mujhe mera division of work ye hai. To ye tamam cheeze wo accept karte hain. फिर एक कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ये है ब्यूरोक्रेसी का कि इट इज रिलेटिवली कंटिन्यूअस इन इट्स ऑपरेशन, यानी आपने हुकूमत तो चलानी है, ब्यूरोक्रेसी इज अ परमानेंट इंस्टीट्यूशन, इट इज नॉट अ टेम्पररी इंस्टीट्यूशन, वेयर एज the parliament, the legislature, both the houses of the parliament and the chief executive or the prime minister or the president, they may be temporary because there has to be an election and new governments may come in, there will be a time lag. So bureaucracy provides the continuity to the whole process. Yani bureaucrats, public administrators jo hain wo to us waqt bhi maujood hain jab elected hukumran nahi hai, elected representatives ke absence mein bhi wo apni duties usi tarah saranjam dete rehte hain. Jo bureaucracies ko service provide karni hai wo karti rehti hai, police apna kaam karti rehti hai law and order ka, हेल्थ वाले अपना काम करते रहते हैं. तो हुकूमत की मशीनरी चलाने के लिए ब्यूरोक्रेसी जो है हर वक्त मौजूद होती है. सो इट इज अ कंटिन्यूअस ऑपरेशन, इट इज एन ऑन गोइंग ऑपरेशन. वेयर एज जो इलेक्टेड लोग हैं जो हुकूमत कायम करते हैं, जो पार्लियामेंट में आते हैं, जिनमें से मिनिस्टर्स होते हैं, प्राइम मिनिस्टर होते हैं या प्रेसिडेंट होते हैं, ये तमाम साहिबान जो है एक खास मुद्दत के लिए आते हैं और फिर अगली हुकूमत आती है. लेकिन ब्यूरोक्रेसी में कोई चेंज नहीं आता. हाँ, ये हो जाता है कि एक ऑफिसर इधर से उधर ट्रांसफर हो गया, लेकिन मोस्ट ऑफ द स्लॉट्स आर ऑलवेज फिल्ड, जितने भी ब्यूरोक्रेटिक स्लॉट्स हैं, और हुकूमत का काम सफर नहीं करता, चलता रहता है कंटिन्यूस. दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट ऑफ ब्यूरोक्रेसी कि वो नेशन स्टेट को, गवर्नमेंट के चलाने को, कंटिन्यूटी ऑफ गवर्नमेंट को इंश्योर करती. Then the spheres of competence of bureaucratic administration are specified. आपने क्या करना है, आप किस एक्ट में हैं और आपकी पावर्स क्या हैं और आपने क्या करना है, ये बिल्कुल क्लियरली डिफाइंड होता है. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अगर आप एक डिस्ट्रिक्ट में DCO हैं तो आपके बिल्कुल क्लियरली स्पेसिफाइड पावर्स हैं, आप क्या कर सकते हैं, आपका क्या जॉब डिस्क्रिप्शन है, आपकी पावर्स क्या है, आप उन पावर्स के बियॉन्ड नहीं जा सकते. इसी तरह एक पुलिस ऑफिसर जो है, एक SP जो है, उसकी पावर्स भी बिल्कुल डिफाइंड है. वो अपनी पावर्स ही एक्सरसाइज करेगा, वो मैजिस्ट्रेट की powers nahi exercise karega. Wo judge of high court ki powers nahi exercise karega. Aur na hi wo constable ki powers exercise karega. Uski apni ek khas powers hai. Within the law. Jo ki kanoon mein likhi ja chuki hai, jo ki rules mein likhi ja chuki. Aur wo unse tajawuz nahi kar sakta. To ye ek bahut badi baat hai. कि हर महकमे में हर अफसर को पता है कि उसने क्या करना है, उसका रोल क्या है, और यह भी पता है कि वो क्या नहीं कर सकता या उसको क्या नहीं करना चाहिए. तो वेबर ने यह सबसे पहले कॉन्सेप्ट दिया था कि हर ऑफिशियल को, हर ब्यूरोक्रेट को, हर एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर को अपनी पावर्स का पता होना चाहिए और वो लीगली एम्पावर्ड हो थ्रू लॉ और कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन और थ्रू रूल्स, और इस तरह वो एक रैशनल ब्यूरोक्रेसी जन्म देगी जो कि एक आइडियल ब्यूरोक्रेसी हो सकती है. फिर वो लीगल रैशनल कॉन्सेप्ट जो है उसमें एक कैरेक्टरिस्टिक हायरार्की का है, यानी हर महकमे में देर इज अ चेन ऑफ कमांड एंड देर आर नंबर ऑफ ऑफिसर्स एंड ईच ऑफिसर इज ओवरसीन सुपरवाइज्ड बाय अनदर ऑफिसर. And all these officers have to be very well trained. It's only possible to have a rational bureaucracy if these officers are well trained in what they do. They are rational in their approach, keeping, of course, the rules and regulations in view. So one of the characteristics for a rational and a legal setup of bureaucracy is that the persons should be well qualified, well educated and trained for their jobs. And this is what happens in every bureaucracy. There are these huge training institutions which you attend to become more and more competent at your job. And you are given training according to your discipline, according to your service, what you are going to do. If you are going to be a tax collector, you will be given that kind of training. If you are going to be a finance person, you will be given that kind of training. So you have to be technically qualified, very well qualified, to be able to work in a bureaucratic slot. Of course, relevant to your field. Another interesting thing is that the job you do is not your property, it's not, you don't own it. It belongs to the organization. You can be transferred at any time. Although you should have a tenure, but you can be transferred at any time. So the job is not there for you, for keeps, forever. It is the job of the organization. Very soon someone else would be doing it. And hopefully, wo banda bhi jo aapko replace karega, itna he technically qualified hoga, kyunki usi process se aaya hoga. Usi kisam ke recruitment procedures follow hue honge, jo aapke liye hue the. Usi kisam ki training mili hogi jo aapko mili hai. तो वो इक्वली कॉम्पिटेंट होगा वो जॉब करने का. द सक्सेसफुल एंड कंटिन्यूइंग ऑपरेशन ऑफ ब्यूरोक्रेसी इज बेस्ड ऑन रिटन रिकॉर्ड्स, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. अगर आप नोट डाउन नहीं करेंगे ब्लैक एंड व्हाइट में हर चीज, यू आर नॉट अ थोरोब्रेड bureaucrat. Because you have to give reasons for your decisions. You have to quote rules and laws for the decisions taken by you. And those decisions will serve as precedents for later officers and in case of later events. So it is very necessary and it is a must that the bureaucrat, to ensure good governance, records everything. Because decisions can be challenged as illegal or not on merit, and then you'll have to defend them. Also, for historical purposes and continuity, the record should be there. What happened when? For example, if I purchase 500 computers and have no record of how it was done, why 500 computers were required, how I went through the purchase procedure, did I go in for the lowest bidder, and everything else. All these things have to be recorded for the sake of continuity, for the sake of fair play, and because you might have to defend your actions sooner or later. So record keeping is an essential part of all bureaucratic institutions. And the bureaucratic official is personally free. He is not a slave. He or she is not a slave. And appointed on the basis of conduct. Your technical qualifications and your conduct land you in a position. And in order to continue in that position, you have to perform. Or jo bureaucrat hai, wo bilkul 100%. According to Weber, uska jo rational legal concept hai, usko bilkul impersonal hokar, unprejudiced hokar, rules ke mutabik decisions lene honge. Aur apni authority rules ke mutabik exercise karni hogi. And as I said before, appointment and transfers, job placements and replacements keep on happening in bureaucracy. But ideally, this should be based upon the technical qualifications of a person. Let us also underline the fact that administrative work is a full-time occupation. It is not a part-time activity. You can't do other things while doing administrative work. In fact, in bureaucracies there is a period even after you have retired, after which you can enter politics or indulge in such activity. Your work is rewarded by a regular salary and prospects of advancement in a lifetime career. रिवॉर्ड क्या है इसका यानी आप प्रोग्रेस करेंगे अपने करियर में एक लेड आउट करियर है आपके लिए अगर आप एक पोजीशन में भर्ती हुए हैं अगर आप सेक्शन ऑफिसर भर्ती हुए हैं तो आप डिप्टी सेक्रेटरी बनेंगे आप जॉइंट सेक्रेटरी बनेंगे होपफुली आप एडिशनल और सेक्रेटरी भी बनेंगे सो अ क्लियर कट करियर प्लान हैज बीन डिजाइंड फॉर यू And of course, you keep on getting your salary regularly. Or, of course, at the end of it, since this is pensionable, all civil services in the world almost are pensionable. At the end of your career, you have a pension to carry with you. Bureaucrats are subject to control and discipline in the conduct of work. Very important. No concept of a bureaucrat without someone controlling the bureaucrat. And the highest level, the secretary level, is supposed to be controlled by the elected minister. And there has to be discipline. So the whole organization has to be disciplined. The hierarchy is meant to discipline. The hierarchy is meant to provide a mechanism for supervision. So this kind of control makes it a rational setup. Bureaucrats are expected to know what their legal position is. Personally also, what is your legal position in a particular organization is important. It is not just that you are implementing laws and not taking a decision without the coverage of law, but you should also know what your own legal position is. So in this model, legality in all aspects plays a very important role. And the way you work, you are supposed to work in a rational manner. Now, what are the advantages of such a setup? Precision. When you work in accordance with the law and the rules are clear-cut, you are bound to be and should be precise. You don't have much play, not much room to play around. You have to be precise and to the point and make a decision based on rules and regulations. Speed. According to Weber, there would be speed. Things would be done speedily because everyone knows their job and the higher echelons are supervising you and want things done properly and quickly. And there would be a reliability. Because of the hierarchy and because of everything being done under the cover of law, decisions would be reliable. The person who's taking the decisions should also be reliable. So reliability is another advantage pointed out by Max Weber. Then discipline. This comes automatically. Because, like all regimented setups, well, civil service is not as regimented as the army, but still, there is this very clear subordinate and superior relationship. Very clearly defined interaction between them. Clear-cut supervision and overseeing of the work of the lower echelons. So discipline is embedded in the Weberian concept of bureaucracy. Continuity, we talked about this before, that bureaucracy provides continuity to the affairs of the government. Whether there be a disaster, a natural disaster, or absence of a elected government, the bureaucracy would be there. The bureaucracy would be there in times of crisis. The bureaucracy would be there at all times to continue with the affairs of the states in a legal manner. Operational uniformity. This is another advantage put forward by Weber. He says any bureaucracy anywhere, two bureaucracies are comparable because they are operating on the same principles. Principles of legality, principles of hierarchical command, principles of written records, principle of proper work subdivision. So, operational uniformity would be there in two systems of bureaucracy. Operational uniformity would be there in different agencies of the same bureaucracy. So if you know how one bureaucracy works or how one department of the government works, the other one would, you'll find, also works similarly. As far as the principles of functioning and management are concerned, of course the content would be different. According to Weber again, this model results in less friction because everything is spelled out. What you're supposed to do, what you're not supposed to do, who is in charge, who is going to oversee you. So since all these things are spelled out, there is less room for friction or tug of war. Actually, so I don't know, we'll see. For Weber, bureaucracy signified two main aspects. Number one, the first is technical in approach, the second is political. The first one is organizational. You've got to have the right person for the right job. And the second one is the system of government or the political content. He also said, technically, bureaucracy is an impermeable and complex hierarchy with emphasis on principles of organization, recruitment, education, training, conditions of service, and rules of business. We have already discussed most of these things. We know that it's a complex hierarchy. There may be 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 echelons in the hierarchy. Recruitment process has to be very, very transparent and organized. The education and training, again, has to be fairly uniform and technical in nature. Conditions of service are spelt out. Now, the last, rules of business is extremely important. Rules of business are a set of rules which govern the working of different ministries and organizations of the government. They lay down the powers of the ministers, of the secretaries, and lower rank civil service officers. And they also lay down the relationship between all these organizations. For example, according to the rules of business of the government of Pakistan, any ministry which is going to take a decision with lot of financial implications, let us say, purchase of 100 locomotives or aircraft or any other major financial undertaking, any undertaking which involves a lot of finances, the rules require that the proposal, which would ultimately be approved by the Prime Minister, be routed through the Finance Division, because Finance Division is in the picture of how much finances are available or will be available or can they be available. Similarly, at times it is a must that the proposals be routed through the Law Division, and so on. So all relevant organizations have to be consulted according to the rules of business before the file is put up for final decision by the competent authority, which could be a minister or the prime minister or any other competent authority which is empowered to take a decision of that magnitude. So Weber's bureaucracy will depend heavily on these rules of business, clearly laid out powers of everyone and clearly laid out mechanism of consultations and approvals. Weber described the ideal type bureaucracy to be a more efficient and rational form of organization than the previous alternatives, and which were termed as charismatic and traditional domination, whereas Weber's bureaucracy is legal domination. So the previous systems, which were based on charisma or ad hocism, where one person would order and the orders would be taken and implemented, called traditional domination. But Weber's bureaucracy was dominated by law. So he called it the legal, rational, bureaucratic setup. The rational legal system is most stable system, both for subordinates and superiors. This is so because it clearly lays out their powers and each one has to perform according to law. So it is difficult for the supervisor to push his superior into doing something which is not in accordance with law. And also, it's good for the subordinate if he can't be pushed into a corner easily. Subordinates can challenge superiors based on rules. We again come to keeping of records. The subordinate can record that this order is not in accordance with the law or rules on the subject and as such should not be carried out and send the file back to his superior. So this is how it safeguards the rights of the superior and the subordinate. Weber's concern was how to curtail power of persons in specialized positions and control over expanding state bureaucracies. Weber envisaged that bureaucracy is going to expand, no two ways about it. And persons who get all these technical qualifications and are exposed to a certain subject for a long time become very, very technically qualified and professionals. How to curtail the power of these people? Because they will try to use their power unfairly also. So this was a very, very genuine concern of Weber. This happens all the time. Now turning towards the criticism which was thrown at Weber, it was said that this vertical hierarchy you're talking about can become chaotic and counterproductive. Itni lambi hierarchy ho jayegi, itne zyada stages or echelons usme ho jayenge ke chaos ho jayega, itna time lagega cheezon ke karne mein aur wo counterproductive ho jayega. Aap jo keh rahe hain ki ye speedy hogi, ye efficient hogi, nahi hogi, kyunki aapne hierarchy aise bana di hai, one officer controlling the other, then another one controlling him, then another one, as we see in our own country. There is at least a hierarchy of 5-6 officers before the file is ready for a final decision. Phir unhone kaha ke ye jo aap competencies ki baat kar rahe hain, People can be competent and they can know the law, but still, there is no surety that they will not act contrary to the spirit of law. Any law ek cheez or spirit of law ek cheez. It is very possible that this legalistic setup you're talking about might end up working contrary to the spirit of law. And also, nepotism, corruption, infighting, and other degenerations may ensue. और ये होता है हम देख रहे हैं हमारी अपनी ब्यूरोक्रेसी में करप्शन पार्टीबाजी ब्यूरोक्रेसी में इन फाइटिंग हो रही है फॉर पावर और ब्यूरोक्रेसी डीजेनरेट करती जाएगी एक और क्रिटिसिज्म ये था कि ऑफिशियल्स में अवॉइड अकाउंटेबिलिटी सीक एनोनिमिटी बाय अवॉइडिंग डॉक्यूमेंटेशन और प्रोड्यूसिंग कंफ्यूजिंग डॉक्यूमेंटेशन कि कई ऐसे ऑफिसर्स होंगे जो कम से कम डॉक्यूमेंटेशन करेंगे ताकि पकड़े ना जाएं अगर गलत काम कर रहे हैं या वो डॉक्यूमेंटेशन को बहुत कंफ्यूज कर देंगे तो वो जो आप कह रहे हैं कि रिटर्न रिकॉर्ड बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है और उससे ट्रांसपेरेंसी आती है शायद वो सही ना हो और उसके लिमिटेशंस और क्रिटिसिज्म जो थे कि जी आप ऑफिस की ज्यादा बात कर रहे हैं ऑफिसर की क्वालिटीज की इतनी बात नहीं कर रहे हैं आप कह रहे हैं ऑफिस इज इंपॉर्टेंट Powers therein are important. Legality of that office is important. What it can or cannot do is important. What about the actual officer who is going to perform? You have not focused on him enough. और अगर आप इतने ही rational हो जाओगे, तो शायद आपकी efficiency भी negative हो जाए. आप इतने efficient ना रहो जितने आप होना चाहते हो. क्योंकि योर एबिलिटी टू मेक करेक्ट डिसीजंस में बी कटेल्ड बिकॉज यू आर बीइंग टू रैशनल टू लीगलिस्टिक यू आर ट्राइंग टू प्रोटेक्ट योरसेल्फ एंड इन दैट प्रोसेस यू मे नॉट मेक करेक्ट डिसीजंस और मेक मार्जिनली करेक्ट डिसीजंस वी डू नॉट रियली कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट प्रोडक्टिवली It was also said that values, ideas, and purpose influencing decisions may be there. That value judgments may come in, personal ideas of people, and their own personal requirements, their personal agendas may influence the decisions. And there is no way to check that. और फिर ये जरूरी नहीं कि बहुत ही ज्यादा नॉलेजेबल हर ऑफिसर हो अपने जॉब के बारे में सो देर इज दिस लिमिटेशन हाउ मच डू यू नो अबाउट योर जॉब इफ यू आर अ टैक्स कलेक्टर और इफ यू आर इन द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ ट्रेड एंड कॉमर्स हाउ मच डू यू नो अबाउट द WTO regulations? You may not know much. So there are extent of knowledge. If not continuously upgraded, will affect the quality of decision making. And also, the persons may not be loyal to the organization. Just rewarding them by a regular salary, but giving them so much power, may be counterproductive. And instead of being loyal to the organization, the officer may become loyal to himself more than the organization. Then they said that because of the specialized nature of the job, that you want them to be so technically qualified in one subject which they are going to deal with, there'll be a tendency to over-specialize. And that will bring in a myopic view about issues as far as that officer is concerned. He will not bother about other aspects of the problem. He will have no idea about what macro impact the decisions may have. So over-specialization may be counterproductive. There's also a possibility of slowing down of everything, because there is so much rigidity and so many procedures to be followed, so many laws to be complied with, and you have to remain within all these bounds. This will produce inertia, and then coupled with the hierarchy, the long hierarchy present, there's bound to be slow decision making. And also, because of an in-group feeling amongst the bureaucrats, they may be resort to this phenomena of group thinking. यानी आप अपने आप को एक ग्रुप तस्वर कर रहे हो और उसी के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से सोच रहे हो. आप पब्लिक के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से नहीं सोच रहे, आपने जिनको सर्व करना है उनके पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से नहीं सोच रहे. आप आपकी अपनी एक ग्रुप थिंकिंग डेवलप हो गई है, जो आप समझते हो कि ठीक है कि हम जो कर रहे हैं वो ठीक है. तो अगर आपका ऐसा एटीट्यूड है तो ना आप अपना बिहेवियर चेंज कर पाओगे, और ना ही आपने अगर कोई मिस्टेक्स किए हैं तो यू विल बी एबल टू रिड्रेस और करेक्ट दोज मिस्टेक्स. एंड दिस हैपेंस, दिस इज क्वाइट कॉमन इन ब्यूरोक्रेसीज. अ ग्रुप ऑफ ब्यूरोक्रेट्स सिटिंग इन अ मिनिस्ट्री थिंक दैट दे नो एवरीथिंग, that they are the ones who are the most technically qualified to carry out certain things, that they don't need any feedback, that they don't need any additional information, that they don't need any additional knowledge or latest knowledge on the subject. They have a group thinking about it, and because of that they will make mistakes, their decisions will not be in keeping with the environment, and furthermore, because of this group thinking, they will not be amenable to feedback or register their mistakes, and hence they will never correct their mistakes. This is one of the problems really which our bureaucracy in Pakistan also suffers a lot. And another criticism or problem rather with the bureaucracy is that they think they are always right, so they will even disregard valid data or information, valid information, proven information, which is otherwise. They will not take it into consideration while making a decision. Just because of that group thinking, just because they think that they know everything. Then bureaucracy creates more and more rules and procedures, increasing in complexity and diminishes coordination and creating and creates contradictory rules. ऐसा भी होता है, बल्कि definitely होता है कि bureaucracy expand करती जाती है, साथ साथ और rules बनाती जाती है, जिससे procedure और ज्यादा involved और complex हो जाते हैं. उसका नतीजा क्या निकलता है कि ना आपस में coordination रहती है bureaucratic echelons में, और मुख्तलिफ अदारे कॉन्ट्रडिक्टरी रूल्स एक ही सब्जेक्ट पे बना देते हैं. सो दिस हैज बीन नोटिस्ड एंड देर आर एनामलीज विच फ्रॉम टाइम टू टाइम द ब्यूरोक्रेसी ट्राइज टू डू अवे विद. एनामलीज आर इंस्टेंसेज वेयर देर आर टू डिसीजंस ऑन द सेम, टू डिफरिंग डिसीजंस ऑन द सेम इशू. So this problem is definitely very much there. And last but not least, the bureaucratic setup envisaged by Weber curtails the use of common sense, because you have to do everything strictly in accordance with law. Aap legal jo raasta hai usse bilkul daibai nahi ho sakte, ek zarra bhi daibai nahi ho sakte. Lekin agar kahin common sense kuch aur keh rahi hai, to kya aapko adjust karna chahiye ya nahi? Typical bureaucrat nahi karega, because the typical bureaucrat wants to protect himself or herself. Thank you.